In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. The earth was without form and void, and darkness was on the face of the deep. And the Spirit of the Lord was moving across the face of the waters. And God said, "Let there be light." And there was light. And God saw that the light was good.
People of hope, our hearts are full of anticipation for the coming of our beloved Christ child. Let us light the candle of hope.
Joy to the world. Our God is now coming to bring us good news. Let us light the candle of joy.
In the name of that child who was born long ago to become the Prince of Peace, we now light the candle of peace.
We are a people who seek to be brought together by the love of Christ, acknowledging God's free gifts of grace. We light the candle of love.
Tonight is a night for which we have all been waiting. Our Advent wreath will now be completed by the lighting of our Christ candle. For unto us a child is given, unto us a Savior is born, and the order of the world will be upon his shoulders. With the birth of Jesus, our lives will be forever changed. We will be transformed by his model and message. We light this candle to represent that Christ is truly the center of our lives. Amen.
Isaiah chapter 9, verses 2, 6, and 7. The people walking in darkness have seen a great light. On those living in the land of the shadow of death, a light has dawned.
For us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government will be on his shoulders. And he will be called Wonderful, Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace.
Of the increase of his government and peace there will be no end. He will reign on David's throne and over his kingdom, establishing and upholding it with justice and righteousness, from that time on and forever. The zeal of the Lord Almighty will accomplish this.
Let us fall.
prophecy, Micah 5, verses 2 through 5. But you, Bethlehem Ephrathah, though you are small among the clan of Judah, out of you will come for me one who will be ruler over Israel, whose origins are from old, from ancient times. Therefore, Israel will be abandoned until the time when she who is in labor gives birth and the rest of his brothers return to join the Israelites. He will stand and shepherd his flock in the strength of the Lord, in the majesty of the name of the Lord his God. And they will live securely, for then his greatness will reach to the ends of the earth, and he will be their peace.
Let us share together now in our Christmas prayer that is on the screen in front of you. Almighty God, there are many things we can bring to Jesus. More than anything else, we bring ourselves. May we come humbly to the manger. May we hear the song of the angels. May we journey with the shepherds to find the Christ child. May we this day, Lord, praise and glorify your holy name. Amen. And now we pray as Jesus taught us, saying,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Sent from God to a city of Galilee named Nazareth, to a virgin betrothed to a man whose name was Joseph, of the house of David, and the virgin's name was Mary. And he came to her and said, Hail, O favored one, the Lord is with you. But she was greatly troubled at the saying, and considered in her mind what sort of greeting this might be. And the angel said to her, Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God. And behold, you will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you shall call him Jesus. He will be great, and will be called the Son of the Most High, and the Lord God will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there will be no end. Merry Christmas, Norton Park.
Thank you.
Matthew 1:18-25. Now the birth of Jesus Christ took place in this way. When his mother Mary had been betrothed to Joseph, before they came together, she was found to be with child of the Holy Spirit. And her husband Joseph, being a just man and unwilling to put her to shame, resolved to divorce her quietly. But as he considered this, behold, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream, saying, Joseph, son of David, do not fear to take Mary your wife, for that which is conceived in her is of the Holy Spirit. She will bear a son, and you shall call his name Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins. All this took place to fulfill what the Lord had spoken by the prophet. Behold, a virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and his name shall be called Emmanuel, which means God with us. When Joseph woke from sleep, he did as the angel of the Lord commanded him. He took his wife, but knew her not until she had borne a son, and he called his name Jesus.
Where they keep it. of Jesus. Luke chapter 2, verses 1 through 7. In those days, Caesar Augustus issued a decree that a census should be taken of the entire Roman world. This was the first census that took place while Quirinius was the governor of Syria, and everyone went to his own town to register. So Joseph also went up from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea in Bethlehem, the town of David, because he belonged to the house and line of David.
He went there to register with Mary, who was pledged to be married to him and was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for the baby to be born, and she gave birth to her firstborn, a son. She wrapped him in cloths and placed him in a manger, because there's no room for them in the inn.
Luke 2, verses 8 through 20. And there were shepherds living out in the fields nearby, keeping watch over their flocks at night. An angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid. I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all the people. Today in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is Christ the Lord. This will be a sign to you. You will find a baby wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger." Suddenly a great company of the heavenly host appeared with the angel, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to men on whom his favor rests."
When the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let's go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has told us about." So they hurried off and found Mary and Joseph and the baby, who was lying in the manger. When they had seen him, they spread the word concerning what had been told them about this child, and all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds said to them. But Mary treasured up all these things and pondered them in her heart. The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things they had heard and seen, which were just as they had been told.
Matthew 2, 1 through 12. Now when Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judah, in the days of Herod the king, behold, wise men from the east came to Jerusalem, saying, "Where is he who has been born the king of the Jews? For we have seen his star in the east and have come to worship him." When Herod the king heard this, he was troubled, and all Jerusalem with him. And assembling all the chief priests and scribes of the people, he inquired of them where the Christ was to be born. They told him, "In Bethlehem of Judea, for so it is written by the prophet, 'And you, O Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are by no means least among the rulers of Judah. For from you shall come a ruler who will govern my people Israel.'"
Then Herod summoned the wise men secretly and ascertained from them what time the star appeared. And he sent them to Bethlehem, saying, "Go and search diligently for the child, and when you have found him, bring me word, that I too may come and worship him." When they had heard the king, they went their way. And lo, the star which they had seen in the east went before them, till it came to rest over the place where the child was. When they saw the star, they rejoiced exceedingly with great joy. And going into the house, they saw the child with Mary, his mother, and they fell down and worshipped him. Then, opening their treasures, they offered him gifts, gold and frankincense and myrrh. And being warned in a dream not to return to Herod, they departed to their own country by another way.
We come now to the opportunity to give and to share with the living Christ, ourselves, our love, our gifts. And please continue to keep ear out for ways that we as a congregation are supporting our area communities by offering gifts, by presents, and things that we are doing for the community. In all these things, we give thanks for all that God has blessed us with and look forward to share his blessing with others. Blessing to be with you for this Christmas Eve. And if you have been worshiping with us for our Advent season, you know that we have been doing a whole series based on the historic trees of the Bible and how they are a part of our own Christmas story. We learned how the fig tree reminds us of hope. We remembered that a palm tree from the Bible is a symbol of joy. We have also learned probably the one we're most familiar with is that an olive tree or olive branches symbolize peace. And then this most recent Sunday, we learned how the cedar is a reflection of God's incredible and inclusive love. I hope that one of the things that these type of conversations might have done for you is have you wonder about trees and how they might remind you of different parts of God's embracing of the world. For me, from East Tennessee, the trees that have come to mind the most are oak, and I know they have them here. Oak are for us, certainly in East Tennessee, some of the most majestic and mighty trees. An oak was a part of my first childhood memories of holding the swing that my dad put up in the backyard. It also came to symbolize something significant when we found National Geographic photographers and journalists traipsing across our backyard looking for an ancient tree that had had a carving in it. Later, when the National Geographic article came out, we found that it had had a carving on it that said, D. Boone killed a bear here. Of course, that's Daniel Boone killing a bear. That piece of wood was put into a museum nearby in Elizabethton, Tennessee. So we never did know where that tree exactly stood, nor did we find the stump, but it was still kind of fun to be close to something that famous. And we could always go back and look in National Geographic and see and say, look, there, that tree used to be in our backyard somewhere. It meant Daniel Boone had come through the area. Later, when I and my family moved to Boone, North Carolina, one of the places where Daniel Boone had worked most often, and when I served churches on both ends of Meat Camp, which is where Daniel Boone used to have his hunts start and end from, it felt like I was touching a part of my history and remembering that tree so long ago that told me that there had been someone there before. I find that as we come to Christmas and we are reminding of all the great things that come with Christmas, like this tree, the tree that really matters to me the most is the one that makes up the cross. Because without the death of Christ and his resurrection, Christmas would be meaningless. I don't mind the Christmas tree. In fact, I'm delighted by it because it reminds me that we're still again in territory for evergreen life, the promise of following someone who's been there before and maybe even more worth following than Daniel Boone or my own beloved, as you know, Dolly Parton. When we see the cross, we see a tree that could have symbolized death, but for us means life and life eternal. And that's what Christmas is all about. So I hope that as you come through this season, you too are reminded through trees all around, whatever they might be, that we are going to follow the one who hung on a tree but didn't stay there. He came and gave us all the opportunity for eternal life. And it's that which we have to look forward to this Christmas season and beyond. Merry Christmas to you and your family. Amen. Let us share in the responsive reading. I will not curse the darkness in this dreary world. Instead, I will light a Christmas candle and pray its glow will spread.
I will not blame my neighbor for his color, ways, or creed, but I will seek contentment in helping those in need.
I will not be an island, considering my life complete.
I will try to share enrichment with everyone I meet.
Yes, I will light a candle so that in its spreading glow,
my life will reflect the image of God wherever I go.
Let us pause for a moment to reflect and prepare for the reality that truly we have been given the greatest gift of all, Jesus. Our benediction. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God, and in him was life, and that life was the light of all mankind. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it.